What I'd like to start out with is the reproductive system is one simple question. Why? Why do we have a reproductive system? It's not rhetorical. Okay, so we have an answer up here that it's a command in the Bible to increase. So is that the entire reason for the reproductive system is just to pass on the genetic information to the generation? I'll give you a hint, that's a very naturalistic point. What else do you do with it? Well, let's find out. So you're all very stuck in a naturalistic worldview. Basically, you're doing just the biology. And the biology is not the only important aspect of the reproductive system. So if it was just the only important thing, simply was for that biological directive, generate offspring, we'd have a lot of issues. And actually, we do have a lot of these issues because this is a germane view. This is the pervading view of society and culture today. So if it's just simply because we have a biological perspective, we have this drive to pass on our genetic information, then I very easily can get to a point where I can say we need to cleanse the races. Only the strong races should reproduce. We should only reproduce in an environment that's conducive for reproduction. So if we were to have pregnancy occur outside of a financial stability stable environment or a nutritionally stable environment, we probably would want to get rid of the offspring. If someone else is in competition for the resources that are on me that I need to protect my immediate offspring, I should be able to kill them. I should be able to remove them from the equation. That's a really dark view of the world. But that's exactly where the naturalistic perspective leads us. That's exactly where we would go if we just simply said that the only reason for the reproductive system is to provide a new generation of my offspring to exist and to be carried on from generation to generation. Now, certainly, we are commanded to go forth and multiply. If we look at a literal interpretation of Genesis, the biological basis for the reproductive system is procreation. But there's so much more than that. And we can't miss this. We can't miss that the reproductive system also fulfills this desire that we call a sexual desire, and a desire for arousal. And those things are extremely important as well. And because of these second items, sexual desire and arousal, this eliminates the possibility of the naturalistic worldview being a predominant worldview for the believer. Not only are we commanded to go forth, but we're commanded to become one flesh. And that's actually a physical command. It's not just, okay, you're going to marry, and you're actually becoming one flesh. And the reason that you become one flesh as your relationship within the context of marriage is supposed to reflect the very essence of Christ himself, the reason we become one flesh is because it's a relational connection that leads to emotionality. Physical and spiritual connection. And also, God says in Genesis, that all things were created for his pleasure. And his pleasure comes from our enjoyment. So yes, there is a biological drive inherent in all of us that says we want to be fathers or we want to be mothers. But there is also the emotionality and the connections and the enjoyment that are entirely separate from that biological drive that leads towards a completely different worldview. Now, it's not just about passing on and protecting your offspring. Those are good things. But it's about emotionality and connection and enjoyment as well. Well, what are we going to focus on in this class? It's human biology. So we're actually going to deal with the biology. And where I want to begin is a look at the male reproductive system. Now, I've heard before someone compare the male reproductive system to the female reproductive system just simply as one is inside out of the other. And that could be further from the truth. There is some similarities that we'll see, but even the development of certain tissues come from two distinct different lineages, embryonic tissue lineages. The way the systems function, very, very different. The organs that are involved are very, very different. So we're going to deal with these, as we should, as separate individual organ systems. If you look at all the organ systems, we say that there are 11, right? There are 11 organ systems, and reproductive systems always kind of clump together. The problem with that is the male reproductive system is an entirely different reproductive system than the female reproductive system. And I want to really highlight those differences, and I want you to realize that those differences are important and that gender and definition of sex and the biological definition of sex really are important, and we can really dispatch of this whole idea of gender fluidity because of the biology that's inherent and those biological differences that are inherent between male reproductive system and female reproductive system. So if I could give one big purpose in the biological context, so now basically stepping away from the desire and the arousal aspect and looking specifically at the biology here, if I can give one definitive description to the male reproductive system, it's sperm delivery. And really, sperm delivery, which you have an anatomy of a sperm cell here, sperm delivery is, we're going to find out, really the rate-limiting step when it comes to reproduction. So sperm is the male reproductive cell. So sperm is the male reproductive cell. And this cell that contains 23 chromosomes in humans at least, 23 chromosomes from the male of the species, makes it possible for reproduction, really recombination of 23 chromosomes from mom, 23 chromosomes from dad to create a new individual at the point of conception. It makes it possible. But even just the presence of sperm, fertilization, totally impossible. The fact that you're all sitting here is totally impossible. You shouldn't be here. The probability that a single sperm will make its way to a single egg, the odds are extremely low. So the odds are extremely low. Low odds of fertilization. Everything that we do with the male reproductive system is to overcome these low odds of fertilization. It's probably more likely that you're going to get attacked by a bear today while being hit by lightning. than for fertilization to occur. So we have a lot to do to get over this odds barrier. One of the things that we do is the male reproductive system is designed to produce and deliver an unbelievably large amount of sperm cells in one given time. So for a highly vigorous, fertile male, at any given time, at least 100 million sperm are going to be available to fertilize an egg. So 100 million sperm. So really, it's not just about getting one sperm to the egg. We basically provide 100 million sperm to the egg to increase the likelihood that fertilization actually can happen. If we just reduce this number even by half, down to 50 million, or half again, down to about 25 million, the likelihood of fertilization goes so low that people who have low sperm counts, 20 million, have to usually use some sort of reproductive assistance to pass on their genetics. That's still a ton of sperm, right? 20 million. And the odds of reproduction are so low at that point that it's nearly impossible to naturally fertilize an egg. So we got to produce and maintain 100 million sperm at any given time to maintain optimal fertility. What we're going to find out is the job of fertilizing an egg and reducing those odds, increasing the likelihood by reducing the odds of fertilization, doesn't just end with the male. There's a lot of really interesting things that we're going to talk about that happen in the female as well to overcome the fact that this possibility of single sperm fertilizing an egg is nearly impossible. And we're taking the impossible and we're making it probable through a series of really, really unique designs that helps this possibility to become a reality. So 100 million sperm, got to produce them, got to maintain them. So what's the process involved in sperm production? Sperm production occurs in the testicular tissue. So sperm's going to be produced in the testes. And the testes are contained within a structure called the scrotum. Now, sperm are extremely thin. So these cells are really, really thin. What you're looking at here is basically a cross-section through the scrotal skin into the testicles, or into the region that contains the testicles. And there's a variety of different elements in here that help optimize sperm production. One of the most important things for sperm is that they actually develop and mature at the right temperature, which is 35 degrees centigrade, about 95 degrees Fahrenheit. Normal body temperature is about 3 or 4 degrees above that Fahrenheit, 2 degrees above that in centigrade. Okay? So if we don't regulate temperature, we decrease sperm production. And that's a tremendous problem. So we're going to have to regulate temperature. Again, that ideal temperature, 95 degrees Fahrenheit, which, by the way, just to put this in context for you, if your body temperature were to decrease to 95 degrees overall, and your entire core body temperature dropped to 95 degrees down from 98.6 degrees, you would be very hypothermic, and it would be medically emergent. You would probably die. Okay, so 95 degrees is significantly less than 98.6. So the fact that the testes are contained within this structure, this actually allows the regulation of the testicular temperature. within the scrotal structure, you have smooth muscle that can contract and relax to control the distance of the testicular tissue to the body. And so you need to think of the body as basically being a warm oven. That's 98.6 degrees. And then we use that smooth muscle to contract to pull it up and cradle the testicular tissue closer to that heat source. Or if it's going in excess of that temperature, we can actually utilize smooth muscle relaxation to move it a further distance away. And we go out through the whole day regulating very stringently that 95 degree temperature simply by contracting or relaxing those muscles. So if temperature begins to drop below 95 degrees, those smooth muscles contract, and this results in the testicular tissue being moved closer to that heat source, the core body temperature at 98.6. And then the opposite is true as well. If we start to heat up above 95 degrees, this isn't good for sperm production, and so that smooth muscle is triggered to relax, and this allows the testicular tissue to descend further away from the core body temperature. Now, in addition to just being able to move, and there's several muscles that aid in this. A couple of them are the cremaster muscles and the dartos muscles. The dartos muscles are actually around embedded within the skin, and those can contract and sort of cradle the testicular tissue up closer. The cremaster muscle is a ligament muscle that descends down from above that also can contract, shorten, and pull up on that testicular tissue to aid a much closer proximity to that core body temperature. But another thing that's really interesting here is we have a circulation that descends down. This part of the testicular tissue or of the scrotal tissue is called the spermatic cord. And basically it's a piece of tissue that's wrapped up that has a bunch of different material. It has nervous system supply, it has blood supply in there, it also has the ductwork where the sperm are actually being produced and being matured. And the thing that's really interesting about this is we have this thing called a countercurrent exchange system. And really what you need to think about in terms of a countercurrent exchange is you have two different tubes. And these two different tubes basically have blood flowing in two directions. So we have blood that flows down this way towards the testicular tissue. So here's my testes here. This is back up towards the heart. And then we have blood that flows back up this way. The blood that comes down in the artery leading towards the testicular tissue is really pretty warm. It's about 98.6 degrees. I don't want to put all that warm blood around that testicular tissue where I'm trying to protect and grow the sperm cells. Because if I do, I'm really changing the environment that's conducive for spermatogenesis to occur effectively. So what happens is this blood begins to circulate down. Right next to it is this vessel, this vein, leading away from the testicular tissue that's carrying blood that's already interacted. Now, that blood circulates out towards the surface of the testicular tissue, and it circulates through the testicular tissue. And as it does that, that heat is removed to the external environment. So as it circulates through that surface of skin and then begins to flow through the testicular tissue, that heat is released into the external environment. That blood temperature drops significantly. We get a lot closer than 95 degrees. In addition to just the heat being radiated away, we now have blood that's coming back that's actually at 95 degrees, may even be a little bit lower than 95 degrees because of the dissipation of heat from the testicular tissue. That means that on this side, I got 98.6. I got 95 or maybe even a less over on this side. Heat always goes from higher areas of heat to lower areas of heat. And so heat actually begins to leave from the arterial blood at 98.6, slowly reducing heat accumulation as we move closer and closer to the testicular tissue. By the time we get out here, we're a lot closer to 95 degrees where we're going to interact with the tissues that help support sperm production. We go through all of this with smooth muscle contraction and relaxation, the countercurrent exchange system within the vasculature of the testicular tissue in order to maintain that optimal temperature of 95 degrees. If we go in either direction, and really the big contributor is to go higher than 95 degrees, we significantly reduce the ability to produce and maintain sperm so much that we basically become infertile. So it's critical that we keep temperatures very close to 95 degrees. So we have several redundant systems between the cremaster muscle, the darkest muscle, and then what's called the pampiform plexus, this countercurrent exchange system that helps to support the temperature exchange within the testes. So when you look at the testicular tissue at more of a microscopic level, what you'll find is it consists of ductwork. Okay? So what you're looking at here is a cross-section through, so we're looking at the sagittal plane kind of on the side through really the whole pelvic cavity that contains the internal and external genitalia for the male reproductive system. And then we blow up the testicular tissue here, and inside what you can see in cross-section is we have this ductwork or all of this tube, all of this tubular system. And in the wall of that tube, so lumen here, wall of the tube here, is where the process of producing sperm is actually going to occur. So I want to just first introduce you anatomically to this ductwork, and then we'll come back and we'll take a look at the actual sperm production process. So within the testicular tissue, the testicular tissue, basically think of a testicle, it's sort of like an Easter egg, where you got this wrapped up structure, and packed inside of there is all of these winding tubes, all of these convoluted tubes. Those are called the seminiferous tubules. And these are actually going to be the tissue where the sperm are made. And it just so happens that that seminiferous tubule, which is the sperm-producing tissue of the male reproductive system, they're contained and protected within a structure called the testes. Now, as this tube is coiled up and wound through the testicular tissue, all of these tubules come together, and we have this structure that sits sort of on, you can see it a little bit better here, but it sits on top of or on the side of the testicular tissue. It's more wrapped up coil, and that coil of tissue is called the epididymis. By and large, the testicular tissue containing the seminiferous tubules and the epididymal tissue, by far this is where sperm production, or most sperm production and storage is going to occur. So we're going to find out that sperm production occurs here in the tissue of the seminiferous tubule and then of the epididymis. Sperm storage then occurs, so production in the tissue, storage in the lumen of the seminiferous tubule. So all the seminiferous tubule comes together and forms the epididymis. Now the epididymis is this collection of seminiferous tubules coming together, and so we form within the epididymis a tube that leads away from the testes. So it's structurally or anatomically outside of the testes. And now we're in a single coil tube. And here we have a bunch of coil tubes, kind of a network of coil tubes inside of the testes that come together, form a single tube that coils up in the epididymis. So we have a single coiled duct here in the epididymis. And this is the outlet from the testicular and epididymal tissue to a structure called the vas deferens or the ductus deferens. So the vas deferens or the ductus deferens. Alongside of the testicular tissue, the epididymal tissue is going to act as a major storage location for sperm cells until they're going to be used. And the process of using them is called ejaculation. Okay, so this is where we're going to store those sperm cells until we can use them or until they're going to be used. From the epididymis, we lead into the vas deferens. It's actually more proper to call the vas deferens the ductus deferens. And this tissue within the male reproductive system Okay, so the vas deferens or the ductus deferens, it's going to be a tubular structure. Okay, so testicular tissue, epididymal tissue, and right here is the ductus deferens. And what you'll see is it wraps up, kind of descends around the bladder. This is your ureter coming down from the kidney to the bladder. And then I have a bunch of structural anatomy here within the male reproductive system. And it's going to be the ductus deferens that leads from the epididymal tissue into this area here. And most of this is going to be glands and other structural components that help in the process of sperm delivery. So ductus deferens leads to that area that contains the seminal vesicles. And a structure called the ejaculatory duct. Now, the vas deferens is going to provide some small amount of additional storage. Most of the storage for the sperm after it's been produced is in the lumen of the seminiferous tubule and in the single coil within the epididymis. But we will have some additional storage. Remember, we're talking about 100 million sperm cells. That's a lot of sperm cells, and so we need a large amount of storage for those cells. So we're going to provide some additional storage. But this is primarily going to be that conduit between storage and then the tubes that are used for sperm emission. So once we get into this region of the internal genitalia, you can see that we have a couple different structures that interact. Here's the vas deferens coming around. And we have cross-section here. And so what I want you to notice in this cross-section, epididymis leads to the vas deferens leads into this tube here, which is actually the urethra shared between male reproductive system and male urinary system. It's not shared in females. So that's one of the major differences between males and females. Within that tubular system, especially where we have that bifurcation leading away from the urinary bladder and leading from the vas deferens down into the urethra, there are three glands in particular: the seminal vesicle, the prostate gland, and then this really interestingly named bulbourethral gland. And all three of those, remember, what are we trying to do here? We are trying to optimize the probability of successful fertilization. And these three glands are going to be involved in that process. So we'll start here with this vesicle called the seminal vesicle. the seminal vesicles are going to be responsible to pass sperm basically from the vas deferens, the ductus deferens, to the urethra. Now, a big or a major component of the seminal vesicle is smooth muscle. And during emission, sperm emission, that smooth muscle is going to actually aid in the movement of the sperm. So the sperm aren't just simply swimming up the vas deferens and down through the urethra. They're actually going to be propelled with this smooth muscle action that provides rhythmic contraction and rhythmic movement of these cells to deliver to the female. Okay, so seminal vesicle passes the side into the urethra. Surrounding the urethra are those glands. We'll come back and we'll talk a little bit more about the physiology of those glands. Smooth muscle contraction emits sperm into the urethra. Now, the urethra is contained within the external genitalia, what would be called the penis. And the external genitalia is actually going to assist to maintain the openness of that urethral tube. If we close it off, sperm delivery is inhibited. That's going to reduce probability of successful fertilization. So structurally, we have basically cavernous tissue within the external genitalia. It gets flooded with blood, which helps produce the erection. And by doing so, that tissue is going to maintain an open urethra. And this increases, during sperm delivery, the probability of successful delivery of all 100 million sperm. So we're not going to lose any of them because of a non-erect external genitalia. So we maintain opening through use of the erectile tissue contained within the external genitalia. Okay, so that's the whole anatomical pathway here. Now let's talk a little bit about the actual physiology of sperm survival. So when the sperm are in storage, they're exposed to blood supply, nutrient and oxygen delivery, waste removal. So life for a sperm in storage is really just like any other cell. But when the sperm are called on for emission, we're basically going to take them away from that comfortable home, and we're going to expose them to a completely new environment where there is no nutrient delivery, there is no oxygen supply, there is no waste removal. So during emission, as those sperm are moved from the testicular tissue, the epididymal tissue, through the vas deferens, they begin to interact initially here with the seminal fluid. And in the seminal fluid, I'm sorry, in the seminal vesicle, within the seminal vesicle, we're going to generate a fluid called seminal fluid that's going to help to prepare sperm for this survival. They have to really survive 4 to 5 days after emission within a foreign environment that has a different immune system, is a hostile environment because we're trying to protect those openings from bacterial infection and viral infection. I mean, everything is stacked against sperm cell survival after emission. So what do we do to actually enhance the survivability of sperm? Well, as those sperm are moved through the seminal vesicle, they're going to be immersed in a solution that's called semen. So sperm and semen are not synonymous. Sperm is the cell. Semen is going to be the fluid that contains the sperm cells. And that semen is extremely important for survival. So remember, what are some of the things that we have to overcome? We have to overcome a foreign environment. We have to overcome a low pH inside of the vaginal cavity, because we don't want to expose our sperm to a low pH, an acidic pH, which is bad for sperm survival, but it's actually good for hygienic maintenance of the vaginal cavity, protection from bacterial infections and things like that. We no longer have a consistent food supply. We have to sort of keep these sperm alive for 3 or 4 or 5 days in order for fertilization to be successful. So there's a lot of barriers that we have to overcome. Are you beginning to understand why I started with this is like totally impossible? So what are we doing to make it a problem? So compositionally, the sperm is really produced, I'm sorry, not sperm, semen. The semen is produced as we go past these three structural locations in the seminal vesicle, the prostate, and the vulval urethral. Okay? So in the seminal vesicle, the sperm are going to be immersed in a primordial form of semen called seminal fluid. So the seminal vesicles secrete seminal fluid. And that seminal fluid is going to contain fructose. So one of the chemical components, I'm going to tell you about another one here in just a second as well, one of the chemical components is fructose. Fructose is a sugar, and it actually can be utilized as an energy source for the cells to continue to produce ATP that's needed for flagellar, the flagellar motor, you know, the sperm cell, once we're delivered into the uterine environment, the sperm have to make their way up to where the eggs are being released, which is in the fallopian tube. So we need an energy supply. It's a very energetically demanding process. The seminal fluid basically packs the lunch for the sperm cell. So fructose is going to be present as an energy source for the sperm. In addition to fructose, there's also a chemical called prostaglandins. And this is crazy. Prostaglandins get deposited into this primordial solution called the seminal fluid. Surrounds the sperm. We're going to modify the seminal fluid on our way to making what's officially called semen. But the prostaglandins actually don't act on the sperm or act in male reproductive physiology. The prostaglandins actually act on female reproductive physiology. So when you look at female reproductive system, what we're going to find out is there's really a side in this, the female reproductive system. You have the ovary on the right side, you have the ovary on the left side. And what happens usually for normal physiological function is the ovaries on opposite sides release a single egg month after month. So 1 month it will be the right side, 1 month it will be the left side, 1 month it will be the right side. Now if you really think about it, 100 million sperm, one of the ways that you can handle that is 50 million up towards one ovary, 50 million up towards the other ovary. That reduces the odds so much that fertilization is almost completely unlikely. It's much better to have 90, 95% of all sperm to go towards where the egg has just been released. The prostaglandins are actually going to interact with receptors that are found in the tissue on the side of the female reproductive system where the ovary has just been released. Those receptors bind to the prostaglandins and you have excessive smooth muscle contraction aiding in the propulsion of the sperm cells in the direction where that egg has just been released. So you end up, because of these prostaglandins, stimulating female contraction, And in doing so, by stimulating female contraction, you assist the sperm cells to have efficient movement towards the most optimal location for fertilization to be made possible. How crazy is that? So it's not just simply, okay, let's give it as much as we can and just hope for the best and split it between the two fallopian tubes. We're like, we got to do this and we have to do it successfully. So we want to put every man in our army on target. So prostaglandins also get deposited here in the seminal fluid. Now, as those sperm now douse the seminal fluid, pass through this portion of the reproductive system, that's called the prostate gland. We're going to change the composition of the seminal fluid here. So we're going to change the composition of the seminal fluid in the prostate gland. Now, the prostate gland produces a fluid that is alkaline. And that alkaline fluid is going to be added to the seminal fluid to alter the seminal fluid so now it contains a more basic or more alkaline, a higher pH, higher than 7 pH consistency. And this becomes really, really important because remember, part of the immune system, that first line of defense, are physical barriers. And we maintain things like our skin slightly acidic, and all of the openings are slightly acidic. So the vaginal cavity is no different. The vaginal cavity is actually normally going to have a lower pH, a more acidic pH, because that's beneficial, that's protective. But it's not very good for sperm cells. It would rip sperm cells apart. It would be a very hostile environment for sperm cells. So the prostate gland adds in some alkaline fluid. And the alkaline fluid is going to be used upon delivery to neutralize that acidic vaginal environment. And so what we see is we see this increase or this rise in pH from a pH of 4, which is protective from an immune perspective, to around 6, which is optimal for sperm survival. Okay? So we added this alkaline fluid to the seminal fluid, continues on through to the vulvo-urethral gland. Does everybody have all of this? Good. Okay, so we now have our fructose prostaglandin containing alkaline fluid passing to the vulval urethral gland. What the vulval urethral gland is going to do is it is going to secrete mucus. It secretes this viscous fluid that basically makes its way into the urethra right before the rest of this solution comes. By secreting that mucus to the urethra, what's accomplished is first that shared urethra, shared with the male urinary system, we're going to wash away any acid residue that's left over from urine. So this mucus basically coats the rest of the urethra, eliminating that acidic nature. That's supposed to be acidic. It also is going to lubricate the urethra. This increases the efficiency of delivery during emissions. And this really optimizes survivability and probability of fertilization extremely high. We go from something that's almost impossible to something that becomes problem because of everything that is happening here. And we're going to see that once we get to female reproductive system, the probability is just continually enhanced.
All right.
I just got a couple more minutes, so let me just start. Sperm production. How do we actually go through this process of generating sperm that can be used to maintain that 100 million, number? So sperm production, which is called spermatogenesis, that's the official term that you would use for sperm production. I'm good with sperm production. So sperm production or spermatogenesis occurs within the cells of the seminiferous tubules. So we're talking about this portion of the tissue here. The lumen is down here. So this part here, lumen's down here. The rest of this is basically a bunch of different types of cells. Some of those different types of cells are going to be involved in the process of producing sperm. And the process really begins out here. This is a layer of epithelial cells that surrounds the seminiferous tubule. And we start up here towards that border. And as we go through, as we go through the maturation process, the cells slowly descend towards the lumen. And as they descend towards the lumen, they differentiate into new cells. Okay, so kind of the picture that I'm trying to paint here is you have a bunch of cells that support the process, and then you have a bunch of cells that are involved in the process of producing sperm. And you'll start out as one of the primordial cells. And you'll slowly make your way through this matrix of other support cells, differentiating along the way until you get to the very center of the seminiferous tubule at the lumen. And hopefully by then you'll be a fully mature sperm cell that can be utilized to pass on your genetic information. All right, so let's talk about the beginning of the process. Up here at the very surface of the seminiferous tubule, there are a bunch of undifferentiated cells. Now, they're not undifferentiated enough to not be cells that eventually become sperm, but they're not a mature sperm cell. Okay? Undifferentiated just simply means that basically it's a stem cell that eventually will become a mature cell. It's not an embryonic stem cell, it's actually an adult stem cell. It's a little bit different, but it's a cell that eventually will become something new. It's going to differentiate, which is that process of adding new physiology and new anatomy to the cell. That undifferentiated cell is called a spermatogonium. Plural would be spermatogonia. So we got the spermatogonium or the spermatogonia. And again, they're out there at the very periphery of the seminiferous tubule. They're out at the edge of the tubule. These undifferentiated cells, they start out as what are called diploid cells. Diploid is a reference to how many sets of chromosomes are present. Now, in a sperm cell, I don't want any sets. I want just 23 chromosomes. I don't want two sets of those 23 chromosomes. I just want 23 chromosomes. Diploid means that I have two sets of my chromosomes. And so really there are 46 chromosomes that are present in 23 pairs. So I'm going to have to take that diploid cell and I'm going to have to split it apart and eventually get to a point where I'm haploid, H-A-P-L-Y-D, with just 23 chromosomes. We'll pick up with that process on Friday.